Our fifth question type for verbal critical reasoning is inference. So what is inference? Inference is deriving logical conclusions from the given facts, or it's an act of reasoning from factual knowledge or evidence. So the question pattern will be such that there will be a passage and then we will have four or five questions, or rather statements, and then we'll have to see if these statements, we're going to infer if these statements apply under five or six options. We're going to look at what those options are from the passage. So for example, if the statement inferred is definitely true based on the facts from the passage, I will click option one. If the statement is probably true, right, we don't have all the information but slight or relevant information is available, then we will click option two if it's probably true. Now, if the statement given wherein the data is inadequate or insufficient, we need some more information, then we will click option 3, data inadequate or insufficient. For option 4, if the statement inferred is probably false, then we will go ahead and click option 4. And option 5 is when the statement inferred is definitely false, meaning to say that we cannot possibly draw this inference simply because it contradicts the facts given in the passage. Then I will go ahead and click option 5, which is definitely false. So we understand what we need to do. We have a passage. We will have four or five statements. We have to make sure if those statements fall under any of these options: definitely true, probably true, inadequate data, probably false, or definitely false. So let's go ahead and look at our first passage. A recent report that satellite data shows groundwater levels in northern India depleting by as much as a foot per year over the past decade is a matter of concern. The clear writing on the wall is that India faces a turbulent water future and veritable crisis without proactive policy and sustainable practices. Besides the poor monsoon this season and the resultant drought situation, Pan India calls for sustained policy focus on the water economy. A whole series of glaring anomalies do need to be addressed. For one, there's far too much reliance on groundwater. For another, our water infrastructure for storage and supply is sorely inadequate. Worse, policy distortions in artificially underpricing answers agri inputs like power has perversely incentivized cultivation of water-intensive crops like paddy in traditionally wheat-growing areas. Now let's understand if there are certain words that are hindering our meaning of the context, right? So what is the meaning of turbulent? Turbulent means disturbing, right? It causes some sort of unrest. Just imagine in the future, if you're going to have inadequate water, that's disturbing news, correct? And what about veritable? Veritable crisis. What does veritable mean? It's a real crisis. It's a crisis that's extremely genuine, right? And what about anomalies? Well, anomalies is deviation or departure from the actual or common form or rule or order, right? So we've gone ahead and looked at certain words which we think will be posing a problem for us in terms of meaning and understanding the context as the whole. Now let's go ahead and look at certain statements and see from the given passage if those statements are definitely true, probably true, maybe there's insufficient data, or probably false or definitely false. So let's look at our first statement. India has failed to take measures to recharge groundwater adequately in northern part. Now that's our statement one. Now I can go ahead and definitely say this is option one simply because the first sentence answers this, right? It says a recent report that satellite data shows groundwater levels in northern India depleting by as much as a foot per year over the past decade is a matter of concern. So we know for the last 10 years this has been a problem, but nobody has done anything. So when I say India has failed to take measures to recharge groundwater adequately in the northern part, we know for a fact that this is there in our passage. That's the first line. So yes, this will fall under option one, where this statement is definitely true from the facts given in the passage. Let's look at our second statement. The second statement reads, wheat cultivation in India requires comparatively more water than paddy. Now here again, this is an easy one because It completely contradicts the fact that is given in the passage. And where do you find this in the passage? In the last line. The last line very clearly says, power have purposely incentivized cultivation of water intensive crops like paddy in traditionally wheat growing areas. So we know that water is more required for paddy and not wheat. But what does the statement say? It says wheat cultivation in India requires comparatively more water than paddy. So it contradicts the fact in the passage. So which means it will be option 5, right? Option 5 is where it is definitely false because it contradicts the facts in the passage. Let's move to statement 3. Statement 3 says water level in other parts of India is stable during the last decade. Now we know that in the northern part there has been some problem. They haven't done anything. It's depleting a foot, you know, every year, right? But we do not have enough information in the passage telling us what is happening in other parts of India. So this will definitely have to fall under option 3, where I'm saying there is inadequate data. There is not enough information supporting this statement. So statement 3, water level in other parts of India is stable. Sorry, we do not have enough information, so it will come under option 3. Let's look at our fourth statement. The fourth statement says, India has now put in place a system to reduce over-dependence on groundwater. Again, this is a clear answer. In the passage, it says, there's far too much reliance on groundwater. It's contradicting the statement, right? The statement says, India has now put in place a system to reduce over-dependence on groundwater. That's not the case. What is happening? We are relying too much on groundwater. That's what the passage says. Which means here again, the facts in the passage is contradicting the statement. This will come under option 5, definitely false. Let's look at our last statement. The last statement says, adequate monsoon helps in drawing less groundwater for cultivation and thus preserves balance. Now, we all understand that in the passage we have some information around that, right? The passage says, besides the poor monsoon this season and the resultant drought situation, Pan India calls for sustained policy water measures. So, having said that, I know for a fact that less monsoon, we rely more on groundwater. So, if there's adequate monsoon, there are chances where we don't have to rely so much on groundwater. It makes logical sense. So here, I would go ahead and say, you know, there is information in the passage. It's probably true. Adequate monsoon helps in drawing less groundwater for cultivation. And thus, there will be some sort of balance where we can manage the water resource, right? So I would go ahead and say this particular statement is probably true, if not completely, because there is some amount of information in the passage supporting the same. All right. So this is the general pattern by which you will have to make inferences. Let's look at one more passage and understand this in detail. India seems to have arrived in terms of foreign institutional investors, FII, inflows. Just why are foreign investors turning to markets such as India? The general consensus is that the US currency outlook is not particularly good. So investors are looking to diversify their exposures and are moving into emerging markets. Investments in India saw better return on equity than all the other emerging markets at 18% last year. The average for other markets was about 11 to 12%. India's growth is largely because of the domestic market, with exports accounting for just 10% of its GDP. Unlike China, which is much more dependent on exports and as a consequence is the US as a buyer. Okay, so this is our passage, right? So let's go ahead and look at our statements and then go ahead and see which option it falls under, right? Our first statement, India had not been a good market for foreign investors. So this is a statement. India had not been a good market for foreign investors. That's what it says. So do you think that's a possibility? And do we have enough information from the passage supporting this? Let's go ahead and look at the passage. See, if you look at the first line, it says, India seems to have arrived, which means earlier, maybe it was not that great. It has come to a position where foreign investors are beginning to notice India, an Indian market, right? And then again, the same line, it says, foreign investors turning to markets such as India. So right now, there is a change, which means earlier, maybe they weren't even looking at Indian market, right, for investment. So I could go ahead and say, if not complete information, at least the first line is giving me some amount of information supporting the statement. So I will go with option 2 saying the statement is inferred, which is probably true. Probably true because there's some information supporting this statement. Let's look at our second statement. The second statement says, investors will get huge profit from investments even in the emerging markets. This is the second statement. Again, if I see, you know, the following statement itself, it says, or the next line it says, investors are looking to diversify their exposures and are moving into emerging markets. So why would they do something like that? Because probably they are expecting some sort of profits. Otherwise, investors will not invest there, right? If they're not going to gain anything. So again, here, if not complete information, there is some information. So I will say this is also option 2 where the statement inferred is probably true. Okay, let's look at our third statement. The third statement reads, return on equity in China was 11% in the last year. Okay. So they're specifically talking about China here. We have information where India did well, 18%, right? And it just says other parts, other markets, the average for other markets was about 11 to 12%. That's what it says. It doesn't say China did 11%. So for me here, the information given is inadequate. I can't go ahead and infer this statement from the passage because there's not enough information supporting this statement. So I will go with option 3, which says inadequate data. Let's move to our fourth statement. Fourth statement reads, thus, US is the largest importer of Chinese goods. Clear winner, right? The last line of the passage, let's look at that. The last line says, unlike China, which is much more dependent on exports and as a consequence, has US as a buyer. So we know that this is definitely true. One, right? Option one, this is definitely true. Because the last line supports this statement, we have direct proof. Let's look at our final statement. India's domestic market is one of the largest in the world. India's domestic market is one of the largest in the world. The information that we have is investments in India saw better return on equity than all the other emerging markets at 18% last year. But just with this information, we cannot go ahead and say that India's domestic market is one of the largest in the world. For that, we don't have enough information in the passage. So this will fall under option 3, where I'm saying the statement inferred has inadequate data. Data is insufficient. So I will go ahead and click option 3 for this. Alright, so keep in mind when you are attempting question patterns of inference, it's very important for you to look at the passage and make sure you have enough facts supporting the information. And if it's not complete information, even if there is partial information, then it will form under or fall under probably true option 2. If not, you will have clear definitions for definitely false and definitely true. Definitely false, it will completely contradict. Definitely true, you will have ample information supporting the statement. And then you have probably true and probably false. Right. So here ends verbal critical reasoning, where we've looked at 5 different question types: assumptions, arguments, course of action, cause and effect, and inference. Here ends the session on verbal critical reasoning. Thank you.